Random House Roads presents Kingdom Swords, Starfist, Book 7, by David Sherman and Dan Cragg. Read for you by John Bedford Lloyd. Clouds made the night so dark, a soldier of the Lord would have had to step on a raider to know one was in the area, and the rain and thunder masked what little noise the raiders made as they crawled through the muck and ground cover toward the Army of the Lord outpost. Lack of visibility didn't bother the raiders. Their plan was detailed. They knew their routes. Nor did the rain bother them. The receptors that lined their sides detected and located life forms, could tell the difference between their own kind and others, and were more effective in the rain than on a clear, dry night. The soldiers of the Lord were all gathered in their barracks or in the duty office. None of them manned the observation posts. On a night like this, they knew there would be no one about to guard against. The soldiers of the Lord had grown to like dark and stormy nights, for it gave them a break from the toils of guard duty at that remote outpost. Which was why the raiders selected a dark, stormy night. Sword worshipful, the duty non-commissioned officer, briefly glowered the displays. He took security duty in the farming lands more seriously than most. He thought most of the soldiers in the outpost risked their immortal souls with their laxness. But glowering at the displays did nothing to improve their efficiency. "I am going to make the rounds," Sword Worshipful announced. The other soldiers looked at him curiously as he donned his slicker. What posts would he check? Everyone who should be manning a post was huddled in the duty office, reading sacred tracts, talking, or sinfully playing cards. There were no man posts for him to make the rounds of. "Soldier Truth, Soldier Hellsbane, come with me." Soldiers Truth and Hellsbane grumbled at having to leave the dryness and warmth of the duty office, but they didn't grumble loudly or long. Sword Worshipful was an easy taskmaster, but a harsh disciplinarian. The five fighters were close to each other, and had a leader seen them, they would have been ordered to maintain the proper interval. But neither leader was close enough to detect their bunching up. Suddenly, a fighter hissed at the others. Something, three somethings, was approaching from the left. Three humans loomed out of the darkness, two slightly to the rear and flanks, one centered and leading. The fighter aimed the spout of his weapon at the centered Earthman, the obvious leader, and shouted the command to fire. Each fighter fired at the closest Earthman. Fluid, vaguely greenish in the dark, shot from the muzzles of the fighters' weapons and splashed on the Earthmen, eating through the waterproof fabric, through the soldiers' uniforms, and into their flesh. The screams of Soldiers Truth and Hellsbane were drowned out by a crack of thunder. Sword Worshipful didn't scream. The fluid had struck him square in the face, was sucked into his lungs, and he began burning from the inside. The fighter turned away, leaving the Earthman to die agonizingly in his own time, and ordered his companions to resume the crawl toward the duty office. Some minutes later, the assistant duty non-com noticed that Sword Worshipful was late reporting in from Post 4. As he wondered why, the door of the duty office burst open and 10 shrieking, growling, barking, man-like hellspawn were in the office, spraying greenish fluid. The soldiers screamed as the viscous fluid began eating into their flesh. Five who weren't hit in the initial volley scrambled for their weapons, but two of them were doubled up in agony before they reached the rack. A third was hit before he could bring his weapon to bear. The fourth was hit by three streams, and his finger spasmed on the trigger of his flechette rifle, spraying miniature darts into one of the raiders. Simultaneously, 20 raiders burst into the barracks. The weapons of the off-duty soldiers were locked in racks. The slaughter was one-sided. In less than a minute, the 56 soldiers of the Lord who manned the outpost were dead. The master commanding the raid ordered all interior surfaces of the office to be sprayed with acid from the weapons, then had the building burned down. The few helix traces left should prove impossible to find. Colonel Israel Ramadan, deputy commander of 34th Fist, believed firmly that a Marine officer should at all times demonstrate austerity in his personal lifestyle and official conduct. But Colonel Ramadan had one weakness, if you could call it that. He loved fine cigars. That morning, as he sat at his desk reviewing the incoming message traffic from Fleet, he decided to have an anniversario. Carefully, the colonel clipped the end off his cigar and struck an old-fashioned sulfur match. He drew slowly as he rolled the cigar over the flame, drawing in the rich, aromatic smoke and exhaling luxuriously. Wreathed in cigar smoke, Colonel Ramadan briefly reviewed the incoming message traffic on his screen. Suddenly, the computer bleeped and a yellow warning flashed across the screen. SPCAT, eyes only, Company 34th Fist. Oh, shit, Ramadan muttered. A deployment order. He set the cigar in an ashtray and typed in his password. Only he, the F2 and F3, intelligence and operations officers, and Brigadier Sturgeon were authorized to read special category messages. And the F2 only got them if he and the Brigadier agreed he should see them. The message flashed on his screen. It was very short, but he had to read it twice. Print, he said to the system. Then, delete. The hard copy would suffice to execute the order. Get me the Brigadier, he ordered the computer system. The screen went blank for an instant, and then Brigadier Ted Sturgeon's face appeared. Sir, I've got to see you right away. Message from Fleet. Come, Sturgeon replied. Colonel Ramadan rushed from his office so quickly he left the anniversario smoldering in the ashtray. Look at this goddamn thing, Ramadan raged. Sturgeon glanced briefly at the paper. It ordered Captain Louis Conorado to report to Headquarters Marine Corps in Fargo on Earth by the quickest possible method of transportation. Nothing else, just a fund citation to pay for his transportation. Sturgeon sighed. I know what this is, Ram. Please sit down. Colonel Ramadan did not know what had happened to Lima Company on Avionia. The only reason Brigadier Sturgeon knew was because General Kazambi, the Army general in command of the operation, had stopped on Thorsfini's world and filled him in on the details on his way back to Earth. Now Sturgeon told Ramadan. The colonel took it all in silently. So I guess despite this Army general's promise, this hoxy woman really has filed charges against Lou for letting her guinea pigs go. Sturgeon slapped the order with his hand. They're keeping us here on Thorsfini's world like lepers, quarantined, because we have knowledge of alien sentience the government wants to keep quiet. That's what I found out when I went back to HQMC. All right, I accept that. But this, he slapped the paper again, this crap goes too damned far. They're taking away one of my best officers because some dried-up old... He let the words trail off. Then, okay, Ram, get Van Winkle at battalion. Tell him to have Lou report to me personally on the double. Back in his office, Ramadan discovered the anniversario had gone out. He relit it. These were the only cigars he knew of you could do that with and lose none of the flavor. He got Commander Van Winkle on the system. Captain Conorado finished reading the message and looked up at Brigadier Sturgeon. I guess General Kazambi wasn't able to get Dr. Hoxie to withdraw the charges. Are you ready to go back to Fargo and face these charges, then? Yes, sir, I am, Conorado replied evenly. Nobody from 34th Fist is being subpoenaed except you, Lou. Plenty of the men in your company witnessed what went on at Avionia Station. Seems to me the court's being packed against you. Conorado thought about that for a moment. General Kazambi will be there. So will Mr. Nast from the Ministry of Justice. I think they're all I'll need to support me. Lou, how long have we known each other? Sturgeon interrupted. Years and years. Since I was a corporal and you were an ensign, Conorado laughed. Since Caesar was a road guard. Since Christ was a corporal, Sturgeon added. By the cheeks of Mohammed's hairy ass.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.